I'm Ryan DeLoach from the Missouri History Museum, and today we're celebrating the 200th birthday of James Eads. Now, James Eads was really famous in his lifetime, but if you know his name today, it's probably because of the bridge that's behind me, the Eads Bridge. Today we're going to learn a little bit more about James Eads and the Eads Bridge through the Engineering a Bridge workshop, which is part of our May homeschool day here at the Missouri History Museum entitled Boats and Bridges. We do have a few goals for this workshop. The first goal is for you to learn about James Eads and the construction of the Eads Bridge. And the second goal is for you to create your own bridge to learn how the engineering process really works. In order to create your own bridge, there's a few things that you're going to need. So here's a materials list. First, popsicle sticks. This is the main material that we're going to use to create our bridge. Now, I know some of you out there may be thinking, oh great, I don't have any popsicle sticks, how am I going to do this? Feel free to substitute other materials here. Other things that could work could be toothpicks, plastic knives, cardboard, but be creative. Find something around the house that you could use. Second, glue. Now there are a lot of different types of glue. Hot glue works great. Elmer's glue, wood glue, these glues work as well. They're just going to need a little bit of time to sit and harden. And that's really where the tape comes in. The tape can be really nice for binding those different parts of the bridge together that you've glued so that they can dry and solidify. Next, you're going to need some scrap paper. This scrap paper is for your brainstorming and for your initial designs that you're going to sketch out. And the pencils for that same reason. The last thing that you're gonna need are some weighted objects. This will be to test your bridge when we're finishing up here after you've created it. So these objects can really be any weighted object, but something that can allow you to test it. Let's go ahead and get started by learning a little bit about James Eads. James Eads moved to St. Louis when he was 13. Him and his family came to the city on a steamboat along the Mississippi. And when they were pulling up to the levee, their boat actually caught fire, and Eads and his family had to jump ship and swim to shore. Shortly after, James Eads actually dropped out of school and started working to help make money for his family. And while he was working, he developed this love and admiration for steamboats and wanting to work on steamboats. He saw that a lot of these steamboats would crash or would sink or would catch fire like the steamboat that he rode on did. So he had the idea to create a salvaging machine that would allow him to essentially dive for sunken treasure down to the bottom of the Mississippi, pull up things that were valuable, and then sell those things. In order to do this, he actually created a diving bell out of a wooden barrel and pumped an air hose down into that barrel so that he could walk on the bottom of the Mississippi. And here he learned a lot about the river. He learned about the mud at the bottom, he learned about the bedrock that was down there, and all of this knowledge would come in handy later when he was building the Eads Bridge. In the 1860s, those in St. Louis were desperate for a bridge to bring goods and people and transportation across the Mississippi River. And James Eads came forward with a plan to build that bridge. Experts at the time mocked Eads. He dropped out of school, he was a self-taught engineer, had no formal training, and he also had never built a bridge before. So the Eads Bridge went under construction in 1867 and wasn't finished until 1874. One of the new technologies that Eads used here were metal caissons that he dropped down to the bottom of the Mississippi. These were filled with air and with workers who actually dug through the mud and built these piers on the bridge directly into the bedrock. James Eads had a lot of knowledge of the bottom of the river from his days as a treasure hunter, and that knowledge came in really handy. Unfortunately, there were several people that did die in the making of this bridge because of something called the bends. When you were down at the depths that these men were working, sometimes over 100 feet deep in the Mississippi, and you came up too quickly, That pressure in your system would lead to decompression sickness. And several people did die in the building of the bridge, but eventually the bridge was completed. When the bridge was completed in 1874, several people had their doubts about the bridge. These doubts had lingered from the very beginning of the construction of the bridge. And so one thing that Eads did to help reassure those that were here was he actually had someone in St. Louis who ran a circus bring an elephant and take that elephant across the bridge. Not only were elephants heavy animals, they were also seen as animals that had a keen sense of danger and wouldn't do anything that would be too dangerous. So when the elephant went across, it helped assure people that this bridge was in fact safe. In another test, Eads had 14 trains come across the bridge simultaneously, just to show that this skeletal steel structure could really hold. James Eads had a big challenge. He had to create a bridge that was over 1,500 feet long that could hold 3,000 pounds per foot. Now, your challenge isn't as big as James Eads' challenge, but you are going to also create a bridge that is at least 6 inches long and that can hold as much weight as possible. At the end of this workshop, we're going to test your bridges and see how much weight those bridges can actually hold. An engineer is someone who designs and builds things, and today we're going to all have the chance to be engineers. One of the first things that engineers have to do is they have to brainstorm how they're going to solve a challenge or problem. So we've already been given our challenge. What you're going to do now is you're going to brainstorm and think about what type of bridge you want to create. There are four main types of bridges: beam bridges, truss bridges, arch bridges, and suspension bridges. I went ahead and grabbed a piece of paper and started to jot out some of the things about these different types of bridges, and you may want to do something similar as you try to decide which type of bridge will be best for your design. You can see I'm sketching out some of the different designs here, trying to think about some of the strengths and weaknesses of these different types of bridges. Here are a few brainstorming questions that you can use as you try to think about what bridge you want to create. How are the bridges similar and different? What shapes are used in bridge building? And also, which bridge do you think would be the strongest and why? These questions might help you come to a decision about what type of bridge you want to create. After you've decided what type of bridge to build, you're going to need to design it. This is the part of the workshop where you plan out what your bridge is going to look like. The best way to do this is really just to pull out a piece of paper and a pencil and start to sketch out your design. When you're sketching out your design, it's important to think about what materials you have available to use to make your bridge. So if you have popsicle sticks, your design should be keeping that in mind. If you're using some other type of material, that's fine. Feel free to be creative. After all, James Eads made his bridge out of a material that no one would have thought to make this bridge out of, steel. So feel free to take inspiration from James. Here's an example of me drawing out my design. I'm building a truss bridge that's mainly made out of triangles. So you can see me drawing these triangles here as I sketch out my design. Once you've finished sketching your design, this is where it really gets fun. This is where you get to actually create your bridge. So you're gonna put all of your ideas together and begin building. So pull out those materials that we talked about earlier. You can see here, I'm putting together my bridge using popsicle sticks and glue. I decided to do a truss bridge, which is mainly triangles, so you can see me putting these triangles together. A few things that I found helpful as I was creating the bridge. First, it was really helpful to just do one side of the bridge at a time.
I'd do the top of the bridge and glue it and set it aside and let it dry. Then I'd do the bottom of the bridge, the sides of the bridge. This really helped give the glue a little bit more time to sit before I tried to put all of the pieces together. That being said, I did use Elmer's glue, so it did take a while for it to dry. So one of the things that I did was I actually pulled out some tape and I started to tape together the different segments of the bridge that I tried to glue together earlier, just to give them a little extra strength as that glue dries and solidifies. So here you can see me taping the different parts of the bridge as I go ahead and finish creating my bridge and let it dry. Once you've finished creating your bridge, feel free to take a picture of that bridge. I'd love to see what you all have come up with. And you can share that with us on social media by tagging the Missouri History Museum and using the hashtag Boats and Bridges. Once you've finished creating your bridge, it's time to test it. Keep in mind that after you test your bridge will probably be broken apart. You can use any weighted objects to test your bridge, dirt, sand, gravel, rocks, jugs of water. Any of those things will work, as long as it's something that you can gradually add weight to over time. I went ahead and used some weights that I had in the house, and you can see me test my bridge here. These are 7.5 pound weights, so that's 15 pounds, 22.5 pounds, and here you see everything fall apart when I try to get to 30 pounds. After you've had a chance to test your bridge, this is where you can really learn from your mistakes. So think about what went well, what didn't go so well, and what you could do to improve your bridge in the future. Then you can go back through the different steps of the engineering process that we've gone through here. You can brainstorm what those changes would be. You can design those changes, then create your bridge using those changes, and then test it again and to see if those changes really did make a difference in how much weight your bridge could hold. One issue that I had with my bridge is when I was looking at it after I did my test, I saw that the bottom of the bridge was in good shape. The top of the bridge was in pretty good shape as well. But what really betrayed me on my bridge was the sides. The sides kind of caved in on themselves. So if I was going to redo my bridge, I would focus on that area. On July 4th, 1874, 200,000 St. Louis residents crowded the riverfront to celebrate the opening of the world's first steel arch bridge. Nearly 150 years later, the Eads Bridge still stands as a symbol of St. Louis, and its engineer, James Eads, is seen as an engineering genius. This concludes the Engineering a Bridge workshop, which was part of the May Homeschool Day Boats and Bridges at the Missouri History Museum celebrating the 200th birthday of James Eads. I hope that you've had an opportunity to learn some new things about James Eads and the Eads Bridge and gain a newfound appreciation for the work that goes into engineering. If you're interested in learning a little bit more about James Eads, I've put up some resources from the Missouri History Museum that can be helpful in doing that. Articles, videos. I've also put a link to our collections where you can access the collections that we have at the museum, including historic photographs of St. Louis like those I used in this presentation. Thanks again for participating, and I can't wait for the day where we can all be in the museum together again.